There's several mechanisms of forgetting of a more biological nature. So I want you to know those for your test. Dementia is one that's prominent and is a problem, especially for older members of our society, but not all of them. Right? It gets worse as people get older, usually starting in the 50s is the early onset type of dementia. Most people who get it don't get it in the 50s or the 60s. But as you get into the 70s, and particularly in the 80s, rates of dementia start to climb rather dramatically for a number of reasons, possibly. And when you get into the 90s, the chances are about 1 in 3 of having dementia, which is a lot. But it also means the chances are 2 in 3 of not having dementia. So 66% chance in your 90s that you won't have dementia. But there are several kinds of dementia. The most well known is of the Alzheimer's type, and it is a progressive dementia, early onset being distinguished. If it happens to hit a person in their late 40s or 50s, that is considered early onset, and the prognosis is particularly poor. The onset becomes more rapid and death is much more sooner. So I've seen that, and it's sad to see. A friend of mine whose father I'd met a few times, I was over at his house, the guy was in his 50s, prominent businessman. He looks at his son, he's like, "Tommy, where's the refrigerator?" And he's not kidding. All of a sudden it just hit him, and he's like, "Dad, it's in the kitchen, of course. Where else would it be?" He's like, "Yeah, yeah, of course, yeah." And he just played it off. And then later that afternoon, the bank called and told him, "Hey, you apparently left your safety deposit box key in the lock." And that's something the man would not normally forget, but then he had difficulty remembering where the bank was. And that was a bank he had been at, banking at for years and years and years, and was just at, right? And so that came on quickly, didn't live but for, I think, 4 or 5 more years after about that point. Most of the Alzheimer's dementia is more of a typical onset in the later 60s and the 70s, and it seems to have this progressive nature. It can't really be diagnosed officially until autopsy, but the signs are clear enough that you can diagnose it with accuracy. It seems to have to do with the neurons that we think with, which are what make up the thinking portions of our brains, and neurofibrillary tangles and tau proteins being built up over time. As they build up more and more, they interfere with transmission of signals and ultimate cognitive decline. So dementia in and of itself is not just loss of memory, right? There's other cognitive problems that go along with that, but memory is typically most prominent and easy for other people to see. So just having higher level thinking can be interfered with as well. Forming new memories is a difficult thing, but you may see somebody has detailed memories for things long ago, but then working with mathematics or abstract concepts or things of that nature might also be problematic. Taking care of oneself as it gets more progressive becomes more and more difficult, and then losing information that's critical to one's own safety or survival becomes kind of the end point at which they cannot take care of themselves anymore. There is the Alzheimer's type, but then there's also one called vascular dementia, which is related to strokes. So we're talking about brain cells here, right? We're talking about tissue that is what we consider to be the thinking tissue of the mind. And when it dies, it dies. Neuroplasticity would say that if there was other healthy neurons in the neighborhood, they might be able to grow their dendrites or axons through the damaged tissue and take over some of the function, but it depends on how extensive the damage is. And so with stroke, right, what do you have? A loss of blood supply to a small area or a large area. It could be a massive stroke or it could be a small stroke. And if you have stroke-related dementia, what oftentimes happens is you see a stepwise progression. A person will lose functioning in some limited area that was related to the affected portion of the brain, and given no other stroke occurs close on hand, they might actually start to recover a little bit of function and might be hit by another one and drop off rather severely, drop off as more strokes hit, you lose more and more and more functioning. With the Alzheimer, you have a much more steady decline over the course of the progression of the disease. So it depends on what the source is as to why, what kind of pattern you would see. Organic amnesia, that's essentially what we're talking about, extensive memory loss due to brain injury or brain trauma. So an accident is one kind of trauma, a blow to the head, a motor vehicle crash, for example, but a stroke is another kind of trauma that occurs internally. So you can have retrograde amnesia or anterograde amnesia. So retrograde is what most people are familiar with, and that's what they think of when they think of memory loss. So loss of information before the trauma, before the injury. So losing information. If I have a blow to the head, forgetting who I am or forgetting important details about my life would be retrograde, because that's information that I had before the trauma that is now not accessible. Potentially, I could recover some of that memory or some of that function if I don't have any further insults to the tissue and I get a recovery period, especially if other people are helping me out. Anterograde amnesia is losing memory for events after an injury, which if you've seen 50 First Dates, that would be the kind of layperson's popular movie that illustrates that, a person who's unable to form new memories. So they have all of their old memories intact, but there's hippocampal damage. HM is usually in most books, that's a patient for whom hippocampal damage was severe and is in an institution and has been studied extensively. And for that person, you might go up and say, "Hi, I'm Chris." And say, "Hi, how are you?" Because all of the social skills are still intact. Everything is going on. Can tell me a little bit about himself, a lot about himself up to the point of the damage. And then 10 minutes later might go, "Hi, who are you?" Won't remember me, because short-term memory, working memory, does not then translate into newly formed long-term memories. So the person who has this kind of damage oftentimes is in the care of others, and they develop little tricks to help them stay on track. I've seen one where a fellow has learned to actually journal all day long everything he does, so that at any given point he can go back and look and see what he's done that day. But you can imagine life is fairly limited when you can't form new memories, even though you have a perfectly normally functioning brain elsewise. That is a critical and key variable to functioning in life. And then we got, these two are related, psychogenic amnesia, which is to say, now it's a little bit out of the biological mechanisms region. Maybe somebody who incurs a stressor, not a trauma in the sense of a actual damage to tissue, but a psychological trauma akin to PTSD, or things that we'll talk about when we get into that chapter, which is toward the end of the semester. So somebody who suffers a psychological stressor or psychological trauma of great, great proportions. Most people won't have a loss of memory, but one possible outcome to that massive stressor is that a person, in rare circumstances, seems to forget themselves or to forget aspects of themselves, aspects of their identity. The most severe version is dissociative fugue, where a person seems to forget who they are and they wander off. Now, this is a person who is functioning normally, mentally, theoretically, up until the point which this stressor came on, and then they have a massive stressor occur to them, and they just seem to forget who they are and wander off. Now, that's not lying, because if it was lying, it would be malingering. So in other words, the person doesn't seem to gain anything by doing this, right? In some cases, it's quite clear that they had no idea what was going on, and that they went off and can even form a new life, potentially. And you're like, "Well, don't you need documents?" Well, there are a lot of people who work without documents. There's a lot of people who are able to make lives without identities. They make new identities. And they may even go on to have new families and really, truly not seem to remember the old ones. But they might come back to themselves at any moment and then realize what's happened and try to get back to that old life. So it's a very rare circumstance. The most public incident I was aware of that seems to fit this was the runaway bride, who happened several years ago. There's a woman, I can't remember where, there's memory, where she was from, but apparently she was getting ready to get married. There was a very large guest list. She wasn't entirely sure she wanted to get married, but she had massive pressure from all sides to go through with it, and she just vanished one day. And apparently had gotten on a bus. She claims not to have remembered getting on the bus. She wound up in another state in a bus station, not knowing who she was or what she was doing. People took, you know, some compassion on her and tried to help figure out what was going on. She seems to have come back to herself about that point, was embarrassed about the situation, and made up a story about being abducted, and it just blew up from there. It became a national sensation, and you can, some people are like, oh, she's just trying to get attention for herself, but that is not the kind of attention that almost anybody in the world would want. And there's no way in the world she could have predicted that it would have become national attention. And she was charged for all the man hours that were put into trying to search for her abductor who didn't exist, et cetera, et cetera. It's a horrible outcome for this woman. So it wasn't something she was doing to play around. She seemed to have snapped under the pressure, lost herself, and when she came back to herself, really didn't know what to do about it and didn't adapt to that situation very, you know, adaptively, for lack of a better word. So biological mechanisms of forgetting, and sometimes there's some interesting aspects of forgetting that just don't seem to be explained by biology. Seems to be an interaction at the very least with psychology, though it possibly has some biological underpinning.